Hello and welcome to the USA Track and Field Course Measurement video. I'm Lance Phegley. This video will demonstrate the proper procedures to accurately measure a road race course and should be used as a supplement to the USA Track and Field Course Measurement Procedures Manual, which can be found at the website below. Today we're going to illustrate the correct techniques to measure a course using the shortest possible route. But before we do so, let's go over some of the items you'll need to get started. Tools of the trade include a bicycle with a kickstand. That's right, you'll find it important to add a kickstand or put back the one you took off. Other necessities include a Jones Orth counter mounted on the front wheel of the bike, a can of spray paint, hammer, nails and tin caps, notebook, pencil, carpenter's chalk, a thermometer, a small calculator, and a tape measure. Now let me introduce Tom McBrayer, Vice Chairman West of the Road Running Technical Council. Tom has been measuring and certifying courses for over 15 years and is one of the nation's experts in course measurements. Tom, we've given a brief overview of some of the tools of the trade, but why don't you explain some of these items in detail?
There's no substitute for the Jones Orth counter. No cat eyes, no measuring wheels. Not if you want to have a certified course. It's the only device recognized by RRTC for measuring a course that is to be certified. The counter mounts on the front wheel of your bike. As the bike wheel turns, the spokes contact this projectant on the counter and advance the numbers. When you see the counter and hold it in your hand, the mechanism will become apparent. Instructions for mounting and using the counter are in the manual. Beside the bike and the counter, most of the other items can be obtained at a hardware store. I use a marking paint, which is used by surveyors to mark utility lines. It's available in upside-down cans from surveyors' equipment stores. Marking paint fades relatively fast compared to enamel, so when it's used in residential areas, you won't get quite so many complaints as when you use something more permanent. While you're at the surveyor store or hardware store, pick up some carpenter's chalk, PK nails, and tin caps. If these are not available in your area, washers are handy. You'll use the chalk for temporary markings and the nails and washers for more permanent markings. The thermometer is used to note the temperature at the start and finish of each ride, both your calibration rides and your measurements. I have a small thermometer that hangs on the bicycle. The hammer is used to drive the nails. When you purchase a calculator, be sure it's not a solar-powered one because you can't read it in the dark. We all know what a notebook and a pencil look like. A 30-meter or 100-foot steel tape will round out your list of necessities. As your technique develops, you'll add other devices to assist you. And it shouldn't be necessary to say it, but we'll say it anyway, never go without your helmet. We do need to bring to your attention that whatever you are going to have on you or your bike during the course measurement should be on you or your bike during calibration. There should be no weight variation. The procedure begins with four rides to calibrate your bicycle for the day. This is done on a flat, level, straightaway course of a known distance. Try to find a straightaway with light traffic and no stop signs. Calibration courses should be at least 300 meters long. Since most races are held at metric distances, you may want to lay down a 300 meter or 500 meter calibration course. How to do that is explained in detail in the manual. I might add that this particular cal course lies between two very specific convenient points and is not an even distance. Since I do most of my measuring at night, I lay out my cal courses between two permanent features, such as expansion joints. That way, I don't have to look for paint marks on the street. Following a warm-up ride of 3 minutes or more, set the counter by turning the front wheel to a convenient number. Some people like zeros on the end, but that's not necessary. Do what you feel comfortable with. What is important is that if you roll the counter past the mark you're looking for, you need to roll it back past that mark and then roll forward again into the count. For example, if you want three zeros on the end and you roll forward to 001, you must roll back past the zeros and then roll forward, stopping exactly at three zeros, freezing the wheel with the brake. Rolling forward into the count eliminates any backlash from the counter. Be sure to read this section in the manual. Place the front axle directly over the end point of the calibration course. Record the date and time of calibration and the temperature. Note again your start count from the Jones Orth counter and enter it in the notebook. Now ride the calibration course, riding as straight as possible and non-stop if possible. Stop the bicycle just before reaching the end of the cal course and roll it slowly forward until the front axle is directly over the finish point. Record the count. With the front wheel locked, turn the bicycle around and place the front axle directly over the line for the next ride. You'll need to do this procedure four times, but for this video, we'll do it only twice. Alternate directions on the course, two rides in one direction and two in the other. The average count for the four rides is used to get your working constant to lay out the course. We refer you to the measurement manual for that procedure. It will also tell you how to figure your total count for the distance you will be measuring and for your intermediate splits. When you have finished the pre-cal, record the time and temperature in your book. We move now to the proposed course, and here we are at the start line. In this video, we are beginning at the start because it's more convenient. However, your race director may have a fixed finish line. In that case, you'll begin at the finish and work back to the start. Mark your start point with a thin paint line. Remember that you may have to adjust it. In your notebook, indicate tape distances to fix landmarks to help relocate this point. Place the front axle of your bicycle over the start line and rotate the wheel forward until you reach a number you are comfortable with. Again, most people prefer at least two zeros and perhaps three. It's not necessary, it just simplifies the arithmetic. But be careful to avoid backlash effect from the counter. Record this initial count in your notebook, then calculate the count for each split you will be measuring by adding your working constant to the initial count. The manual gives a good explanation of this procedure. Mount the bike and begin the first measurement. As you head towards your first split, here are some techniques that could be used. First, note that the measurement is made approximately 30 centimeters, 12 inches, from the curb, or 20 centimeters, 8 inches, from the edge of the road if there is no curb. Already we see an obstacle, a car parked directly in front of us. Ride directly up to the obstacle. Freeze your front wheel, dismount, and move the bike from behind the obstacle, being careful to move perpendicularly to the curb. Release the front brake, roll forward so the bike will clear the obstacle, freeze the wheel again, and move the bike in towards the curb. Remount and continue your measurement. Here we make a right turn, and we'll need to slow down and scooter to maintain the 30 centimeter distance from the curb. Coming around the corner, we note that the next turn will be a left one. Keep your eye on that corner, diagonally across from you, where you'll turn left and head straight for that corner. Again, slow down as you approach to make the turn 30 centimeters from the curb. Taking the tangent or using the diagonal is the way a smart runner will run the course. This is also referred to as the shortest possible route, or SPR. Sometimes there'll be too much traffic to do this, or you may have an extended distance before the left turn. In either case, you'll probably want to use an offset maneuver, which we'll demonstrate next. As we take a right turn again, we stay on the right side of the road parallel to the curb and ride down to the corner where the course turns left. Remember to maintain a 30 centimeter distance from the curb. Choose a spot, such as an expansion joint in the concrete or painted traffic line that goes across the street, and stop your bike at that point. Freeze the front wheel, dismount, and carry the bike to a point directly across the street, then remount and turn the corner. As we round this next corner, we keep an eye out for the first intermediate split. Uh-oh, we missed it on the counter, but not by much. So we'll roll the bike backward, going further back than necessary, then roll forward again into the count you're looking for. Remember that rolling forward into the count eliminates any backlash from the counter. Mark the spot with a thin coat of paint. Note landmarks in your notebook, and we're off again. What to do if an obstacle presents itself, such as this locked gate? We don't just pick up the bike and go around the barrier. Using the procedure shown in the video uses up counts on the course where they should be used and keeps the course from being overly long. Ride the bike right up to the gate, front wheel touching. Freeze the wheel, dismount. Take your builder's chalk, reach down to make a mark on the road surface at the back of the wheel. With the front wheel still frozen, pick up the bike and place the front of the front wheel over the chalk mark. Release the brake and roll forward until the front wheel touches the gate again. Now freeze the front wheel again, pick up the bike, and move to the other side of the barrier. No, it's not always as easy as this, but you'll find a way. On the other side of the barrier, put the bike down with the back wheel touching the fence, and you're off again. This area of the park has a lot of curves, not a straightaway in sight, so we'll make our own straightaway. We measure the straightest and shortest path possible. taking the tangents, moving from one side of the road to the other as necessary, the SPR, just as you'll do if you were running it. If the runners will be restricted to one side of the road, we'll measure the same way, but use only half the road. We're approaching the second intermediate split. Roll up to it slowly so as not to overshoot. Freeze the wheel, dismount, mark the split, and enter locations in your notebook. Now we're rolling up to our final destination, the finish line. Again, use only a thin paint line for now. Note the time and temperature in your notebook, and your first measurement is complete. Back to the start line for the second measurement, which will go a lot faster. Place the front axle on the start line. Take a reading from the counter and write it in your notebook. Note the time also. Now ride the course, again using the SPR. Stop at each measured intermediate point to take a reading from the counter. When you reach the finish line, note the reading, the time, and the temperature. At this point, you'll do your calculations to determine if your two rides are within tolerance. Now take four more rides of the calibration course. Calculate your constant again. If your post-cal constant is greater than your pre-cal constant, you'll have to make some adjustments to the course. The manual is very detailed about this and how to make adjustments. When you determine exactly where the finish line should be, mark it well. A tin cap and PK nail can be used, as well as paint, and a large F. You'll also need accurately taped distance to permanent landmarks. Make a detailed sketch of both your start and finish lines and note the tape distances on the sketch. You'll use this later on your course map. We'd like to show you one more measurement technique, a U-turn or turnaround point, often used for an out-and-back course. You usually have a fixed point to measure to. Here we've marked it with a cone placed over a tin cap and a concrete nail. Ride to that point, freeze the front wheel, dismount, turn the bike around, place the axle at the same point where you stopped, release the brake, and you're off again.
And that should bring things to a close here on the USA Track and Field course measurement video. This video, along with the course measurement procedures manual, will guide you through measuring a course using the SPR. If you have any questions, please refer to the website below, or feel free to email any of the following experts. They'll be more than happy to answer any questions that you might have. Thanks for joining us. I'm Lance Phegley, and we'll see you on the roads.